head because it is raining and I'm trying to hide away. But of course, that's not really my face. Now, we must apologize. The rain and the gremlins have been working together, conspiring all night long on how to attack us. Let me take those off so I don't lose them. Now, we're going to try and head towards where those lions were and see if we can find them. And well, hopefully the rain stops as well. And as you know, Brian is on the vehicle with me today, but you're not allowed to see the thumb just yet, because that's not for the pre-drive drive. That's only for the real show. We're going to head straight towards where those lions were. Let's see if I can see any footprints. No, not anything that we are looking for, just some wildebeest footprints. Oh my goodness, I can't even see today. Okay, let me just get on the radio channel. Good morning, stations. I'm going to be making my way to the last lock of the Nkuhuma Pride on Wahlberg's Twin Dams Junction. Now remember, this is a live safari, and if you're worried that you're perhaps going to miss what's going on and not get the stream up and going, you're welcome to subscribe. And well, then you'll always get a notification as soon as we start the pre-drive drive. And well, I just think it's a lot easier than having to search for it yourself. Now you can see that there's lots of rain droplets on the camera, but we'll get that cleaned up in a moment. Morning, it's just myself, I think, up and ready. I'm just on Wahlberg's Road, making my way to the last lock of those lines. Copy that, Louise. That's affirmative, Lex. I'll call you straight in.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning, and well, as you guessed, it's kind of raining and pouring here. And of course, you know, this is Safari Live.
Ready. Standing by.
Who's out early watching us, or possibly late in the evening for you. Now, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me this morning we've got Brian, and of course the ever so handsome the Thumb. There he is in his suit and tie. He doesn't look very happy this morning, Brian. Is he still sleeping?
No, just tired.
Just very, very, very tired, as you can see. Now, I must apologize again that we have had this delay, but sometimes these things happen out here in the bush, and well, the rain is good for the bush, but sometimes it's not great for us, especially when it comes to electronics. But you'll be happy to know that I've just spotted the lions straight ahead of us. Isn't this wonderful? We didn't have to do too much of a search around. And luckily, this little soaking rain we have had hasn't bothered the lions too much. Oh no, we don't want to drive in that. Some lion dung. But hey, good morning. Good morning, everybody. How are you doing? Wet, I suppose. You all look like you've got big bellies full today. Let's have a look here. Oh, there, we say hello to these beautiful girls first. We're going to just literally do a quick hello with them, because I can see that Mr. Tinio has joined the party this morning too. Now, don't worry, you're not going to just be stuck with me. James is getting ready too, so he should be out in a moment. Look at that lion. Actually seems to be enjoying this cooler weather, I suppose, especially when you have a large belly like that. You'd prefer to have the cooler weather, the rain on your skin, rather than the sweltering heat. Now, I'm going to go forward because they are feeding on the carcass. Let's say hello to whoever's eating. Now, this is a live safari in case you've stumbled across us or you've just tuned in for the first time. Perhaps you heard about it from a friend. And we'd love to hear from you, so you're welcome to interact with us and send us questions. You can either do that by hashtagging Safari Live, or you can send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. Now, I'm just trying to find the best spot. I'm going to poke my nose in over here. We'll go over a couple of little branches so we can get a nice view of them feeding. Here we go. That's better. And we're just obviously adjusting a couple of things. And it is very difficult to do adjustments when you've got all that plastic covering the camera. Hey, Brian. A little bit difficult, but we'll make it work. And now, we're looking at Mr. Tino. You can see he's not very happy with that cub feeding in between his legs. And I don't know how that cub can fit anything more into its stomach. It is so full. And I presume that the rest of the pride is just laying off in the drainage line to keep out of this miserable weather. I'm going to tell Lex that we're here. Lex for Taylor. Lex just relocated. Just come straight to Twindams Allbergs Road, you'll get my visual. Orbs, is that you or is it Texan? You're more than welcome to. You'll be number two, and then Lex will be making his approach. Mobiles, we've relocated on the Nkuhuma Pride as well as two Birmingham boys. We just same lock as yesterday, Wahlbergs, Twin Dams Junction. There we go, now I've sorted it out. It seems as though everybody had the same idea as us this morning, to head out after the rain sort of settled down a bit. And I'm glad we got here first, because there's a very limited view of this carcass. So perhaps Tino was around last night. Maybe he was just hiding away. And well, you can see that that cub is not impressed that it has had to give up its spot at the carcass. Another little one about to try its luck. No, and he's just going to move it away from them completely. That's very selfish. Look at the strength that he's able to turn that buffalo over like that. Isn't that amazing? With so much ease. And now I think, though, we will exhibit the typical feeding behavior of males over the carcass, especially Tino. He's not as tolerant of the cubs and the females well as Mr. Mfumo is. But you can see that little cub, it's about triple the size of what they were yesterday. Look at that belly, it's almost touching the ground. Being very cautious around Tino. See that sort of slinking behavior that they're doing, ducking their heads down, showing that they're being submissive. You better tread lightly. I'm sure you can hear all the birds waking up as well. Yes, be careful, little one. You can see he really doesn't care that the cubs are around. If they're in the way, well, they're going to get stood on. And well, it seems as though he's so focused on feeding on that carcass, he's just going to use the luxuries right there. That's not rain, everyone. Now it would be quite interesting to see if Tino does act quite aggressively towards his cubs, what Mfumo will do. Just because of the interesting behavior we watched yesterday, how he greeted every single female that was around and made a concerted effort to strengthen the bond between the members of the pride. Now, I wonder, I don't know if he would stand up to Tinyo, because he seems to quite enjoy the cubs. And we saw it yesterday, how excited those cubs were to see Mfumo. They came darting over to say hello. Now, Michael, as we're sitting here, you've commented on the way that Tinyo is growling, and you're wondering if he is growling at Mfumo or if he's growling at the cubs. Now, Mfumo doesn't seem to be bothering him at the moment. He's really just sitting, observing, listening. I think it's when the cubs get too close to him. Let's see, let's watch. They'll get under his legs, they get in the way, and of course then they want to feed on the best spot too. He just sort of bulldozes them out the way though. But I suspect if Mfumo does get up, that there will be some tension, as they seem to have eaten. Oh, look at this, Mfumo giving him a stare. But look at this. Even though they may fight over carcasses, that was actually a very nice interaction that you saw there, very brief. Looked over, almost went to nudge heads. And perhaps Mfumo has been bossed around this morning by Tinyo. And now he's had his chance to come in. But look how more tolerant he is around the cubs. He's very relaxed. Ooh, already fighting with one of the females. You can see Mfumo, he doesn't really step on top of the cubs and knock them down. Did you see how he walked around? It's just little things like that that makes me think that he's just got the most incredible genetics and personality, this lion. So calm, very placid, but stern and strong like a male lion should be when he needs to. He's also having a growl at the cubs now. But I don't blame him. Those little ones are now trying to feast where he's got his paws, and he seems to want to turn the buffalo over again. Wonderful. Well, it seems as though James has got Wendy up and running now, so well done to David and James. But let's go across to them so they can officially say hello to you.
Good morning, everybody. It is, of course, quite a misty morning, and that is the stupidest Cape Franklin in all the, not Cape, Natal Franklin in all the Lowveld, standing exposed on a termite mound in this blustery, misty, Scotch misted day. My name is James Hendrick. And on camera today is David, and David probably won't be able to show you his thumb because he is covered by a fairly impressive rain cover. Now, I do apologise for our late start. We're not exactly sure what happened, but here we are. The rain is difficult, and we are broadcasting to you live from the Kruger National Park, of course, and that brings with it certain challenges. Now, Taylor has already found the lions, obviously. Obviously, they're on a dead buffalo. That's where Taylor basically spends her life, either around the lions and them killing a buffalo, or the lions and a dead buffalo that they have just killed. We are going to go and see if we can't find some sign of the queen, Karula, our 12-year-old female leopard, and her 2 9-month-old cubs, and maybe we'll be lucky in this weather. It's not very pleasant out here, but it is quite an adventure to be out, and we'll just see what happens. Please do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv, terms and conditions apply. Louise is trying to tell me that it is 21 degrees Celsius and 69 degrees Fahrenheit. That is absolute rubbish. It's nowhere approaching 21 degrees Celsius right now. I think it's probably sitting at about 16 degrees Celsius, which is 61 Fahrenheit, plus minus. That is because the wind blowing in from the southeast, bringing with it this thick Scotch mist, is, it carries with it a bit of a chill. If the lens does get a little bit fogged up, well, that's just the way of things, I'm afraid. We're now driving directly into the wind. We'll go all the way south and then sort of head north. Now, can't find anything around here. Taylor is static with the lions, so let's head straight back to them.
Now we're still sitting here with these beautiful Nkuhumas. I wouldn't dare move. And while it was relatively peaceful at the carcass, Mfumo has found a spot where he can feed in peace, and the two little cubs are on the other side now. It's showing a little bit of tension towards each other. They have devoured this carcass overnight. But I suppose that was expected after seeing them last night, not looking too full. See how he's trying to now separate the skin from the flesh? How he's tearing into it? Now, of course, some of you may not find this very pleasant, and it can be, of course, a little bit gruesome. So you're more than welcome to go and make yourself a cup of tea or anything along those lines. Perhaps go put the washing out or do some ironing, whatever it may be. We're going to sit here for a little bit longer and watch them feast, as it's important that these little cubs keep feeding, because we know that they've got a little bit of mange and we need them to push through that. Now, looking at this carcass and with my comment saying that they've completely devoured it, Carrie, you were wondering how much is left. Not much. And I think we're going to see, like we saw Tino doing, Mfumo trying to turn it over and try and find a spot where there is some flesh. I suspect by this afternoon, I don't think there will be anything left. You see, look how gentle he is. Even though he's growling. Here we go, reprimanding a cub for not listening to his authority. And we know how cheeky these cubs are. So they do deserve a bit of reprimanding every now and then. But still not as aggressive as Tino is. He, like we just saw him walk over, bulldozer the cubs over. Well, they're quite resilient as well. That's something you must remember, is that these little chaps are tough creatures. And they are able, of course, to handle the odd swat or being stepped on or falling out of trees. They sort of just bounce back again. Now, we really only have been seeing Tino and Mfumo over the last couple of weeks. And towards the end of, I think it was September, we started seeing Nena as well. But I've never seen Blondie. And I know, Roger, you were wondering where Nena and Nsuku have disappeared to. And you're wondering if there's a split in the Birminghams. Now, I don't think that there's necessarily a split. I think that they've separated slightly, not on a permanent basis. I'm sure when they go out and do their territorial patrols, they, of course, will meet up again and greet each other. And I think this way, it seems as though Tino and Mfumo seem to handle the western sector, and Nsuku and Nena cover the more eastern sector. So it's actually quite an efficient way to run a property and to run their territory. Instead of all staying in one place at the same time, make their presence known by splitting up separately. And of course, one lion on their own is not a good idea, so they seem to have gone into pairs, which is actually very clever. It's a very clever strategy. It always amazes me how the cubs get the dirtiest too. From the mud, from the carcass. Well, something that we've also been chatting about over the last couple of weeks is the Birmingham's manes, how lovely they are becoming. And it seems as though Tino's mane seems to be getting nice and dark quite quickly. And Fumo's mane, you can just see that black patch coming out now. Now, Charlie, you were wondering why male lions have manes and females don't. Now, it's very important for these males, firstly, the most important thing is that it protects the vital organs. So that mane is really, really thick. And it goes around and covers the throat. It also covers around the chest and on the back of the neck, which are very vulnerable areas. When we watch lions take down animals, those are the areas they go for first. The throat and, of course, the spine or the back of the neck if it's a small prey. So when they fight, they're protecting those vital organs. But it's also, of course, like we see with birds, the male birds having beautiful voices or beautiful colored feathers. They need a way to also attract the females. And that big mane, well, the darker it is, they say, the more females that a male lion is likely to get. And I actually remember there was a documentary that was done many years ago. It must have been about 13 years ago, where I forget who did it. They built robotic lions. Well, no, maybe not even robotic. I think they were just sort of figures. And they, I don't know, covered them in a lion scent, but one had a dark mane and one had a blonde mane. And they put them relatively close to each other, and they set up a camera, and they watched the interaction as lionesses came through that area. And all of those lionesses first went up to the male. There was no difference in body size either. They went up to the male with a darker mane and rubbed heads. And I thought that was quite interesting, a very interesting study. Afterwards, they realized that they obviously weren't real and there was something fishy, and they moved off. But they did the same greeting, rubbing heads and saying hello to each other. But you can see now there's really not much flesh at all. It seems as though they've feasted upon all the flesh already. But we'll try and hang around for a little bit longer. We also need to give a couple of guides a chance to come and have a look. But I believe James has got an animal that's still in its pajamas.
Indeed, still in its pyjamas, everybody, there is a zebra. Now, I'm going to be quiet for 20 seconds, and I want you to try and tell me the impression you get. Dave and I have got a very distinct impression of the morning so far. I don't know what impression you got from that sort of silence, but it would be good to hear from you. Hashtags for our lives. Send us through a tweet, just with one word, as to how this morning, or the impression that the morning gives you. And then in a little while, I'll tell you what Dave and I think. But it is very quiet, isn't it? Wind rustling the trees. Zebra with its ears flicking to and back, trying to hear something. Now, Jake, you're in New Zealand and you're wondering about whether or not the game drives from the guest lodges go out today. It depends entirely on the guests. It's completely fine for them to go out on drive, but of course they are out on open vehicles, which means they will get wet. And normally what we used to do, Jake, was to give our guests a poncho, something like the one that I'm putting, that I've got on my lap here. And that poncho, Jake, was normally about as waterproof as a tea bag. And of course, as we all know, tea bags are not very waterproof at all. And so, if you didn't want to go out in the rain, because the novelty of being out in the rain with your guests wears out after about 3.5 seconds, what you used to do, and I think I've told some of you this before, is to find the direction of the wind, so in this case southeast it's coming from, and then you would drive as fast as you could into the southeast, so that by the time you'd been driving for 5 minutes, those ponchos that looked very good but were totally ineffectual had become completely wet, and your guests were soaking and freezing to death, and they would normally say, let's go back home for breakfast. And that was what you did. That was a strategy you employed if there was a major downpour. On a day like this, however, it's actually actually not bad. There's a very kind of gentle drizzle falling, which is not so bad, and so even the kind of most rudimentary of rain gear will keep you relatively dry. There's a static lion sighting, so that's pretty easy to go to and take a few pictures of. But yes, I mean, absolutely people go out, but the game drive tends to be a bit truncated, a bit shorter than it might have been otherwise, because it will start to get uncomfortable. Not so bad for me. David's going to be more uncomfortable than I am, because I'm obviously sitting sort of hunkered in here. But for guests, they were, of course, exposed on the back of a big Land Rover or Land Cruiser, and yeah, not great for them. But you know, the big thing is that if you have. Sorry, Winter Prism, I've missed your word. I'm going to ask for it again. Unnerved. Right, unnerving. Good. Right, Roger, you say calming. Now, interestingly, Dave and I both felt like it was a bit creepy out here. It was a sort of a creepy silence about the place. And so, Winter Prism, your unnerving kind of feeling, I think, is a good one. Roger, you're obviously just braver than the rest of us, I think. So what I was going to tell you was about rain. What was I saying? Rain. Taking game drive in the rain. It's gone completely. Ponchos, rain gear. Shorter game drives because of the rain. Oh dear, I've lost my mind. There was something deeply amusing that happened, I seem to remember. Come back to me at some stage. Perhaps. Perhaps not. No sign of Karula at this stage just yet. Oh yes, I know exactly what I was going to say to you. The thing is that often when people come out here, there are obviously the very rich who are able to come out repeatedly. But sometimes people will save up, you know, for 2 or 3 years, sometimes a lifetime to come to Africa, and they'll come only once. And they'll spend 2 or 3 days out here, and then 2 or 3 days in Cape Town, or 3 or 4 days at another reserve, maybe go to Botswana and make something of it. But because it's such it's not a cheap holiday to come out here and stay at some of these places. You know, people very seldom will say, we'll just stay in our rooms for the day. You know, I mean, when you're paying that kind of money for to come and see Africa's iconic animals, it's just it doesn't do to stay in your room, no matter what the conditions. And so we certainly were very appreciative of that, and we would absolutely take people out if they wanted to go out. And it's amazing how quickly people can get cabin fever in a lodge environment. I always kind of like to get it over with, you know, would go out early morning and then, you know, come back for a lovely hot breakfast. That was a really nice kind of, it felt like you'd really earned your keep. As we will feel later on, won't we, David, when we take our first bite of scrambled egg. Right, from one zebra to driving wind and scotch mist, let's head back to the lions and Taylor.
Now, I'm just closing my box with all my books and things in. But you can see Mfumo has now turned the carcass over once again, which is now actually exposed. And we can see a little bit more flesh. You can see that the one back leg, there's still quite a bit of flesh on it. They've eaten sort of one side of it. Doesn't look like they did a very good job of removing the stomach contents, because I can still see so much of that partially digested grass inside. Now that won't be too pleasant. They'll have to dig that out, because there are probably some really tasty morsels in there for these lions to feast on. Now every now and then I'm seeing the odd cub move around from the drainage line, so hopefully we're going to get more and more of them come towards the carcass. But for now, it's just these three here, enjoying themselves. And this is just incredible interactions. It is so refreshing to finally see a male that makes a concerted effort to bond with the different members of a pride. Now, Paul, you were wondering if the lions eat the bones. They will if it's a young animal and it's particularly small bones. However, because this buffalo was not quite an adult just yet, almost there, it's a bit tough and their teeth aren't designed to crush the bones. They've really got that conical shear which allows them to sort of scissor and pull the meat off of it. So that's where something like a hyena will come into play, where they are specialist feeders and their jaws are designed to crush bone between their back molars. And what they're feasting on is not actually the actual bone itself, but the bone marrow inside, which is filled with an incredibly large amount of nutrients. But in the process of crushing that bone, they will obviously digest a couple of pieces, but their digestive systems are incredible. Their stomach acids are much stronger than that of a lion's, that allows them to digest shards of bone up to about 7 centimeters or so. Little ones, I don't know how much more you can fit in those bellies. You're going to have to roll back over to the other lions. Now the wind has actually just picked up and started gusting. So I'm wondering if some of these lions aren't going to get up and move into the drainage line, because it's starting to get very unpleasant out here now. But luckily for us, it's just a little drizzle, so it's not too bad. Oh, do you know where those little ones are hiding, Brian? They're hiding under that fallen tree. You see it right in there? They're on top of it. We can see a couple of them kahumas on top of the tree, but I found their hiding spot. They're actually just sitting below where that one is standing. Quite difficult to see them with the leaves, but they are indeed hiding under there. You can see a bit of movement. Now, talking monkey, you were wondering... Oh, what were you wondering? Sorry, that one completely slipped my mind. I had it in my head, and then, well, it just disappeared. Did you remember what talking monkey said? Well, we'll ask Louise. No, no comment from Louise, apparently. Okay, we'll get back to your question now, talking monkey. Sorry, I apologize. Oh, there we go. That was a nice chunk of flesh. There we go. Sorry. I knew it was something like that. Sorry, talking monkey. I apologize. And you were wondering if lions smell like wet dog. Not quite wet dog. It's a strange smell. Now, I've never really been able to pick up the lion smell. The only time I've ever smelt them is when they were feeding on a rotting carcass. This was a couple of years ago. They then stank like rotting carcass. But otherwise, I don't think they smell unpleasant. I think out of the cats, lions are particularly clean, except when the males start the courtship process and start mating with the females, then they forget about everything. But we constantly see these lions grooming themselves for quite a number of hours every single day. It's a big part of their lives. And of course, we know these little ones, well, they go to mom to get cleaned when they dive inside the carcass, like this one seems to be doing now, not afraid of getting dirty. So I don't think they particularly smell. Maybe James has got another opinion. Brian, do you think that lions smell?
A little bit.
What do they smell like to you?
I can't even describe it, but yeah, they've got a certain stench to them.
So Brian says that they do have a certain stench to them, but he says it's very difficult to try and describe it to anything that's sort of familiar. He says it's unique. But animals that are quite stinky are the wild dogs. They're my absolute worst. That smell, it smells like sweet, stinky socks with blue cheese inside of them that have been sitting in the sun for about 2 weeks. It's horrible. And I also don't like the smell of wildebeest. It smells like off butter that has also been sitting in the sun. Those are smells that make my stomach not feel so wonderful. Though I must admit I'd rather smell those two species of animals than that buffalo that's just near Buffalo's Hook. That is getting quite unpleasant. Now, Leopold, as we were looking at these very dirty lions, you've asked if they will groom themselves. They do indeed. Like I said, they spend quite a large amount of their time actually grooming themselves. These little ones have learned how to lick, and they lick each other, and that's the most effective way to remove dirt. As they've got hard bristles on their tongue that almost combs through their hair too and will remove stubborn ticks, and if there's any bits of vegetation or mud stuck on them, they'll get rid of it like that. And then, of course, the adults, though, help out quite a bit. But I do find that the lionesses seem to be a lot cleaner than the boys. The males are always a little bit scruffy. But I can't believe the difference in these Birminghams in just a couple of weeks. Their size and body, the colour of their coat, not just their mane, but even their hair on their body now is starting to go a little bit darker. They're actually turning into lovely boys. I'm excited to eventually see Nsuku. Now, it seems as though nobody else wants to come and see the lion, so we're going to stay with him for as long as we can. And let's go across to James and see how he's coping. And, well, I hope that his hair is not getting wet in the weather.
You know, these young bucks who think it's funny to make fun of those of us who don't have any hair at all. You know, very amusing joke there, Taylor. Now, we're looking at this tree because it's quite interesting. Well, it's relatively interesting. See how it is a half cast, if you like. It's two different colours. And it's two different colours like that, of course, because this is a frontal rain coming from the southeast. And so the northwestern side of that tree is completely dry, and the southwestern side is completely soaked. I think that's rather fascinating. So if you wanted to avoid getting wet, you could just strap yourself to the northwestern side of that tree and you would remain dry for the rest of the day. Now, there's some impala just up ahead. They're looking a bit bedraggled. And the only thing I've seen, or that Dave and I have seen since you were last with us, was one lilac-breasted roller. And it was the most miserable-looking bird I've ever seen in all my days. It was sitting on a tree, huddled over, soaking wet. You couldn't even see its colours. It was kind of an amorphous black blob with a little bit of blue on the shoulder, and it was just standing there looking very miserable indeed. The rain is now coming down slightly more heavily, which is very exciting, isn't it? Lovely. Now, here are the impala. Still no babies yet, of course. We'll just get past this next bunch of trees and then we can have a nice look at them. Now, one of the things that we've been chatting about, of course, is the imminent birth of the youngsters. And just do excuse the slightly squaffed picture. It's very difficult for Dave to level the camera with the rain covers on. So just bear with us on that. Two evenings ago, Connor and I went out onto quarantine clearings out of camp, and we were sort of wandering about there, and the impala were going crazy. The males sounded like they were in the middle of the rutting season. And I mentioned the other day that I thought that might be due to an influx or an increase in estrogen levels just before the birth in the females, and that, of course, is being picked up by the males, who find this very exciting indeed and then start chasing each other about the place. And then I had some lovely information from a viewer who said that, yes, it is true that estrogen increases, but that it's increased probably throughout the course of the pregnancy. But I wonder if closer to birth, I wonder if somebody could help me perhaps, if in mammal species, perhaps particularly very seasonal ones, which like to try and time their births together, if there isn't an increase in estrogen which might be causing the males to be doing that kind of rutting behavior. They weren't chasing the females, but they were chasing each other around. Very heavily pregnant, they all are. Jay Swish, please do not be confused. Do not be confused in the slightest. You're watching on Periscope and you say, is this live? By the very nature of the fact that you're watching it on Periscope, it must be live. And I think Periscope is the correct place to be watching it today because, well, it feels a little bit like we're in a submarine. Hashtag Safari Live if you'd like to talk to us, anybody. And Jay Swish, I hope that your doubting is now put to rest. We are completely live from the western fringes of the great Kruger National Park. Right, we're going to carry on. The Impala have absconded. They do not wish to spend time with us. We are going to go to Treehouse Dam, where I have almost no doubt in my mind that there will be nothing having a drink because, well, they don't need to. They can just turn their mouths heavenward and water will flow into their mouths. Now, Taylor was wanting to find out what I think wet lions smell like. Well, I got to tell you, I think they probably smell a whole lot better than wet dogs. We were with the wild dogs yesterday, and the dogs were completely dry, and they smelled very niffy indeed. Wet lions, I suppose, probably a little bit like a wet carpet. If they've just been eating, they probably smell a little bit more rank. But, you know, I was talking about this yesterday as well. I don't think lions have a very strong smell. Hyenas definitely have quite a strong smell at the den site, but when they just walk past the car, you don't get much of a whiff of them, and nothing like wild dogs, which really do smell very strongly of sort of damp dog. And I think that's got quite a lot to do with hunting strategy. Obviously, a lion and a leopard. There is a Treehouse Lake off to the left-hand side. A couple of terrapins frolicking in the lake there. That's just Dave cleaning the lens. It's not a terrapin attacking him. I was just saying that I think lions and leopards have evolved not to smell. And while we look at that serrated hinged terrapin, I'll explain why I think that's the case and how I think it's possible. They are stalking predators, which means that they need to get very close to their prey before they can kill it. Ooh, that's another wood sandpiper. It is indeed. He's either very fat or he's just a little cold, so he's fluffed himself out. I think probably the latter. Good. So, sorry, back onto those lions and their smell. A wild dog, of course, is a coursing predator. It doesn't have to get very close before it starts to chase. And so I don't think they have to worry too much about the smell. And certainly there are other animals that don't smell. One of them, of course, is a sable antelope or a roe and roan antelope, both of which do not smell as babies. And they are left in long grass when the adults go off to drink or to feed, and the little ones are totally imperceptible to predators roaming through the grasslands. They do not have a smell, and I think that you'll find lions and leopards have something approaching that kind of a strategy. All righty, on we go. Aqua, a very appropriate name for this time of the year when there is water everywhere. You say, are there any plants or trees that smell distinctly different only as a result of the rain? I know what you mean, but I'm going to say no. I don't think that there are any obvious ones that smell completely different as a result of the rain. Certainly everything smells a bit different. Obviously there's the smell of petrichor. My favourite word, petrichor, coming out of the earth, born of, we think, either bacteria or essential oils that come when the rain touches the dry soil. That fades, of course, the smell of water generally, and then there is the smell of kind of humus, a sort of organic, rich organic smell when you go through the areas where there is a lot of leaf litter on the ground. I'm just going to address Taxon on the radio. Go ahead. Ooh. Going to head back to Taylor and the lions while we wait for Aubrey to give us tracks. Okay, tracks of Karula just behind us. Okay, we're going to head back there. Let's head straight back to Taylor now. Yeah, sorry.
Now, Mr. Mfumo has moved off completely from the carcass. He's saying hello to some of the lionesses. And it's amazing how it seems as though they've actually just worked out on a system where everybody can be happy here. The lionesses first started feeding earlier in the evening yesterday. And then obviously Tinyo came in and probably barged his way through and demanded a piece of the carcass. I'm obviously only speculating. And well, the cubs don't mind, they just feed whenever. And now that Mfumo's got up, some more lionesses are coming through. They don't look particularly fat like the cubs do and like the males do. I don't know if you can hear in the distance, I was just listening to either Mr. or Mrs. Wahlberg's eagle talking in the distance. Come on, little cub, go inside that cavity. I think you would fit perfectly. Now, they really are going to have to turn this carcass around because they've eaten everything on the outside. Now, Brenda, you what? Well, you're asking if I can tell if there's the difference between the sexes of the cubs. Well, this one we're looking at now is a young male. And then you're also saying if the male lions will tolerate the female cubs more over the male cubs at a carcass. I don't think so. I think at this age, they're so young, they're not a threat at all to the males. But we'll see that starting to change as they get older. So once they get to about a year and a half old, we're definitely going to see a change in behavior. And of course, well, the older they get, eventually the Birminghams are going to push those young boys out. But they've got still probably another 2 years or so to go before they even have to worry about that. And for now, they can just rely on the adults catching them, catching food for them. Here's my favorite little girl who's just come out to say hello. She's obviously woken up from asleep. Ooh. And, well, there she is, as feisty as always, not taking any nonsense from anybody. Not even a lion that is 10 times her size. Very cheeky. And I suppose I think that's why she's my favorite. It's actually just so beautiful listening to the peace and quiet, the odd bird chattering in the distance, the smell of petrichor that James is talking about. And you see, that little one is thinking about it. I think that it's realized that there's quite a bit of flesh on the underside. That's all they need to do. They just need to try and turn it over, remove all of the feces that's still sitting in the stomach cavity. And well, then they'll have access to lovely chunks of flesh. Tinyo disappear down into the drainage line, or is he still sitting behind all those trees?
No, he's behind the trees.
Okay, sorry, I'm just trying to see where everybody's moving, and I couldn't see Tinyo for a second. There's Mfumo, and I think Tinyo is sitting at the back behind him, behind all of those trees. I think that's it. Yes, it looks like his mane. You can just see a little bit of it. Too hairy to be a female. I wonder where the other lionesses are, because I've only actually seen two lionesses. Now we obviously want this weather to keep up for the entire day. There's a nice soaking rain. Well, we're watching these lions decimate the entire carcass, and Hunter, you've asked how long will this carcass last these lions? Not very long, I'm afraid. So they took it down yesterday afternoon, probably around 1 o'clock, somewhere around there. And I think it would probably last to about that time this afternoon. Because there's so many of them, they will finish this rather quickly. And there isn't much left. There really is just the one back leg left. And I think that would give them an opportunity to have one last feast. There you go. You can see it's still quite a bit of meat. But then that's it, I'm afraid. And it's like she's making a move around to that corner. Let's see what she does. Cubs don't seem to be too happy. She's looking for a spot where she can find something decent to feed on. Look at the size of the belly on that cub. I mean, it's blown up. It is honestly like it has swallowed a beach ball. Obviously, no more meat can fit into that stomach, so I'll go and harass my sibling who's sleeping nicely and perhaps some four more too. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Now, that's something you don't often see, is the males participating in grooming, let alone the females, never mind the cubs. That is amazing. This is really the first time I've ever seen interactions like this with a male lion, and I think I was talking about it yesterday afternoon. It's not common. A little cub constantly presenting itself to Mfumo, quite happy to be groomed. Oh, that was very nice. That is amazing. It just shows you the big scary male lions. Well, not all of them behave like that. Some of them are actually quite pleasant. And this will be an experience that I will talk about for years and years and years. Now, we've been chatting about these boys, the young male cubs. About them getting kicked out at about 2.5 years old, somewhere around there. Now, Roger, you were saying what will happen to the female cubs? Who will mate with them when they reach sort of sexual maturity? Now, it will indeed probably be the Birminghams, unless another coalition of males come through and take over. But inbreeding is normal. It's acceptable for a couple of generations. It's sort of done in a way that it'll maybe only be a year or two, and then by then the Birminghams would have finished being in the prime of their life and they'd be reaching quite old age. It probably would have battled against a couple of male lions and they'd probably be battered and bruised and tired and weak. And well, then at that time, I'm sure another coalition of males would have come through and taken over the Nkuhuma pride. And then of course there's no worries about inbreeding anymore. But we've still got a couple of years away to worry about anything like that. And we'll see. It could be next week that a pride of lions comes down from the Manuleti or from Kruger. We don't know. And that's what's so exciting, is that you can't predict the future. Oh, I can hear thunder rumbling in the distance now. Now, from May, he wanted to know if all 8 cubs make it to adulthood, would they separate if food became scarce and in search of other places? Now, there's a possibility, but I doubt it with the females. It isn't very common. Typically, the females will stay with their maternal pride. However, I've seen it before where two young lionesses actually separated and joined up on their own and started forming their own pride. So there's an opportunity to, but I think that these lions will stay together and rule the entire northern section of the Sabi Sand. Because there's quite a few ladies here. I think we've guessed, or we've sort of tried to count, and there's about 5 female cubs and only 3 males, if I'm not mistaken. And that'll take the pride, if they all survive, to 10 lionesses. Now that is impressive. And of course they'll have cubs again, maybe they have another 5 that survive, and it's quickly going to grow into a super pride. Then we're going to see these lions changing their diet from not just one buffalo, from taking down a number of buffalo at any given time. And hopefully they'll start going for something like giraffe. Because if you've got 10 adult lionesses and a couple of boys hanging around, well then 2 or 3 buffalo is really not going to last you long at all. We've seen how quickly 5 adult lions, 8 cubs and 2 males can... of course, decimate this carcass very, very quickly. So giraffe will be the next best thing, or even, which will be very rare and probably unlikely, but there's always a possibility that they could, if they get to the point where they're 20 lions strong, could go for something like a young elephant bull, or a young elephant that's been separated from its herd. But it's not very common here in the Sabi Sand. But it wouldn't surprise me if they start targeting giraffe as soon as this pride grows. Mfumo coming back around again. I do apologize if I shuffle. I've just got pins and needles in my leg. And it's the most uncomfortable feeling in the entire world. That must be Floppy Ear who's fighting like that. Or maybe it's not. Now, if you think that we're seeing action now, wait until they get to about a year old. That's just Lex coming into the sighting. That's why those lions pop their heads up. What we're going to have to do is, I think we're actually going to have to pull out and give everyone an opportunity. There's a very limited space here, and I'd love for Lex, and there's another guide coming in, I think Andrew. So we'll do a loop and give them an opportunity. Let's go back across to James and see how he's doing, and I'll let you know what we're going to do when we get back.
Right, the update from here, everybody, is that's obviously a herd of buffalo, but that Aubrey did find some Karula tracks coming into this area. Now, he reckons that she's left the cubs somewhere around here. He's gone east, we're going west, past this herd that have just passed into Juma right now. So if you're looking for a leopard in amongst a herd of beefies, you'll be on the termite mounds, possibly into the trees. You can see that they are walking sort of slowly towards, I guess, the better grazing areas around about the firebreak of Philemon's cutline. That's kind of the direction they're heading. Northwest is where they're going. So we'll just track them gently as we go along, hoping to find one or two tracks. And there you can see that there seems to be quite a lot of grass for them to eat there. Isn't that nice? Beautiful. That's a really nice shot, David. So we're just going to ease our way along here. And we might be lucky to find the crouching form of a spotted cat on a termite mound exactly like that one that you've just seen. And obviously it is a little bit difficult to try and see the tracks when the rain has been sort of making a crust, if you like, on top of the ground. Buffalo herd definitely slightly bigger than the others I've seen. Maybe they'll start to recover now. They've certainly been very, very ropey of late. I'm just going to talk to Aubrey. Go ahead, Orbs. Sorry, confirm crossing south. Sorry, Orbs, I didn't copy that. Confirm crossing south. Karula has gone back south, I'm afraid, into Little Gowrie. Copy, thanks very much, Orbs. So that means that there's not going to be a Karula sighting probably today. Oh well, we've had a nice buffalo sighting. What I think we will do, Tundi has just crossed into Torchwood out of Chitwa Chitwa. She was heading sort of northish and eastish, so I don't think she's going to come towards Juma, but it might be worth heading towards the eastern boundary to see if she doesn't pop across. It'd be nice to meet her again. It'd be especially nice to meet her cubs. Right, that was our little buffalo sighting. We'll carry on this way. And Jamazing... Jamazing, you're watching on Periscope. Very nice to have you with us. Why are those buffaloes walking around so close to some feeding lions? Well, they're not actually very close to them at all. We're probably about, as the crow flies, about 2 miles from the lions. That's a good distance away, and so they don't pose any danger at all. Were they to become aware of the lions, they'd move off quite quickly. Now, Dave, you're in Canada. You have sent through some nice information about the hormones, and apparently estrogen levels do increase slowly throughout pregnancy, and so they've obviously got to a stage now, and apparently that towards the end of the pregnancy there is a bit of a surge, and that estrogen helps with the production of various hormones in the fetus, in those produced by the adrenal gland. And that means, of course, that could well be why the male impala are starting to behave in that slightly rambunctious fashion. So thank you very much for that, JJ. As I always say, we learn as much as from you guys as you ever do from us. Now, I think we'll head on to the Gowrie Main. Sorry, Summer Shade, I'm afraid I've missed your question slightly. A bit of breakup on the radio. Louise, can you go with it again? Right. Right, Summer Shade, you're wanting to know if the Kruger Park is the biggest game reserve in Africa or in South Africa. It's definitely the biggest in South Africa, but it's also, remember, it's a part of a transfrontier park. That means it's a natural area that crosses international boundaries. And the Kruger Park is itself about 3.5 million acres, but it extends east into Mozambique, an additional sort of 2 million acres or so, and then north into Zimbabwe for the remainder of the 8.5 million acres. You can do the maths. So it is a really vast area, of a total of about 8.5 million acres. The biggest reserve, or you know, sort of designated reserve in Africa, is the Selu, and that is in Tanzania. And Tanzania's Selu is 5 million hectares. So that's more than, that's about 11. No, it's more than that. It's about 12 million hectares, so that's huge. But remember, with a reserve like the Selu, There's no fence. So it kind of bleeds into community lands and grazing lands for cattle. And it's massive. I mean, and there are areas like that around the Okavango, while the Okavango-Savuti-Linyanti system in Botswana and leading into Zimbabwe and Zambia, while those areas are seemingly designated, I think there's only a fence in the very southern reaches thereof. And because of that, I mean, they are vast. But in South Africa itself, which is, of course, the southernmost tip of the country and of the continent, that is a RAV4, the Kruger Park is definitely the biggest. Thank you very much for that. Summer shade. Now, there's a vulture up ahead there, so we're going to go crossing onto Arethusa now, which is the reserve to the west of us. We're allowed to go there, of course. So we'll just pop up and see what those vultures are looking at. We'll try and maintain communications with the final control. It can get a little dicey from over here. We'll just go and see. Because, well, David and I haven't managed to find a great deal else, really. Oh dear. Louise, all I got there was but that do. Try again. Oh dear. It's not very good. We're going to stop here, have a look at those vultures, and then turn around almost immediately. I'm afraid I cannot copy the final control. If you're wondering what I'm talking about, everyone, final control is where the directing of the... Ooh, that's ominous thunder. It's where the directing takes place, and your questions go through there, and they then just get fed into my ear. And at the moment, on the control panel is Luisi. Oh, shame. You see that, David? That vulture yawned. Poor vulture, is very tired. I sometimes yawn when I'm a bit cold. These are the white-backed vultures. Now, I saw a question the other day on Twitter about why they're called white-backed vultures and about if the white back actually serves any purpose. Now, you can't see the white back at the moment because the wings are folded over and the birds are looking doubly miserable. That one's tucked its head. Look at that. It's tucked its head right back underneath the wing. It looks like a completely disembodied vulture that has had its head cut off. It isn't, though. The head is there, I promise. Anyway, the white back is underneath the wings, and it serves a very specific purpose, and it's quite clever. These birds feed a lot communally, and they follow that white back. And if they're high up in the air, searching for things to eat, any vulture that is descending down towards a kill will be reflecting that very bright white back. They'll be reflecting upwards from the sunlight, and that helps other vultures to follow them down towards a kill. And that's why we think they have white backs. Okay, I'm going to turn around immediately because I cannot hear anything from final control. Yesterday we had a similar issue, but of course we had a little bit of sunshine so we could use our telephones. Not so today. Righty, on we go. Shall emerge from Arethusa back onto Juma. Arethusa, like I say, a reserve to the west of Juma, where we operate most of the time. And Arethusa, interestingly for this area, is a word in Sepedi. And Sepedi is one of the local languages here, but it's not a common language in this particular part of the world. And it means, let us help each other, as far as I understand it. We've got you now, Luisi. Now, this is what I was talking about here. Good morning, everybody. How are you? Good. Yes, I see that. Here is exactly what I was talking about, everyone. Enjoy it. I don't know if you saw those guests. They have been the recipients of some tea bags around their persons, and they're sitting there going... Wonderful. Right. We had a question about what direction, not what direction, how far Arethusa was from Juma. Well, they border each other, so, I mean, if you're right on the east-western boundary of Juma... hang on a second. I'm just getting mixed comms here. Sorry, I think once upon a time you were asking about whether it's got a different climate. Is that correct? Oh, you say it looks a little bit like two different climates because Arethusa is a bit less green. It is slightly less green, that's well observed. The climate is the same, but, you know, it's very isolated normally. This rain isn't isolated, so this rain's going to rain on everything. But the heavy storm rain we get is extremely isolated, which means you do get that. You get these patches of green and patches of kind of winter vegetation still. And Juma has been the recipient of quite a lot of good rain this year. Arethusa not so much, but certainly more than in the south of the Sabi Sand. Oh gosh, it's now starting to rain quite hard. And so, yeah, it is quite possible that sometimes, especially this time of the year when the rain has just started, that different parts of very closely related reserves look completely different. And I mean, I was on the boundary of Biffle's Hook the other day, and there was a patch there that looked like it hadn't had any water at all. So once upon a time, that is a very sharp observation, especially through the misty lens. Right, we're going to carry on east now. We had failed to find any signal to the west, so I think it's probably just a little bit easier for us to keep going easterly. Ooh, it is getting a little bit chilly now. So let's head back to Taylor and find out how she's faring with those long blonde locks and if they're making her head any warmer than mine.
Sadly, no, James, they're not. And I must admit that I would prefer to have less hair because to try and brush the bird's nest that has now been created in my hair, well, that is going to be extremely interesting. No, sorry, I just had to turn the game drive radio down for a moment. There was a lot of chit-chatter. Right, let's have a look. And it's freezing. It wasn't too bad and wasn't too cold when we first started. But now, I'm shaking. You might hear a bit of teeth clattering at some point, but we'll be all right. We'll survive. Now, we're looking for anything, really. I'm hoping to see a couple of birds. I could hear a black cuckoo shark calling in the distance, but doesn't want to sit still for us, so we couldn't really get it. And I'm still looking for the female black cuckoo shark, which would be nice. Just double checking on some tracks, and of course, well, tracking is quite difficult today unless the animal has just walked there because of all of the raindrops that are now ruining the ground for us, but only for tracking. Everything else about the rain is fantastic. Hello, little dove. We do have one little bird though that seems to be quite happy to say hello to us just on the ground. You can see that is an emerald-spotted wood dove that we're looking at. Normally they don't hang around for very long. And it's quite interesting as to where they get their name. And it's normally exactly what happens when we stumble across them, is that they fly in towards sort of a shrub and sit on the small woody branches. Well, and of course they're in the dove family, so that's where the name wood dove comes from. And it's a pity there isn't any sun today, because then you'd really be able to see those beautiful emerald spots that they have on the back of their wings. Isn't that lovely? Hello, little bird. And just looking for seeds. They don't really feed on any insects. They prefer the seeds and things like that and berries. And very casually walking. Now, this is also a good opportunity to watch the way that this bird walks. And I've told this story before, but when you learn to track and you do the various tracking assessments, the one track that is unmistakable is any dove's track because of the way that they walk. They walk like a man stumbling home, or a woman stumbling home from a great night out, perhaps at the pub. And you can see that, definitely not in a straight line. And that's a feeding behavior, though. That's just sort of walking around in zigzags, looking for some food, eventually going in the direction that it wants to, but of course very slowly and not directly. Thank you, little bird. I'm just having a look to see if there's anybody else around. I can still hear that cuckoo shrike, but it's quite far in the distance. Let's go see what else we can find. Oh no, I've lied. I've picked something for you. I forgot. I picked a flower. Now I must apologize. My hands are absolutely filthy, and you can see that Brian is, of course, wiping away at his lens. Now I can hear something in my ear, and I don't know if it's Louise talking. Can you hear Louise?
Nope.
You just hear a strange noise as well. Oh, I hear a strange noise coming in my ears. I'm not sure what's going on. Anyway, I found this little flower. I'm going to just put it over here for you. Now, as like I said, I apologize. The steering wheel black color is coming off and sticking onto my hands. So look at that, though. Isn't that amazing? That little flower. That is a wild jasmine of some sort. I'm not sure exactly which species occurs here, but it smells delicious. And this is where I wish I could put it right up in front of the camera and you'd be able to smell what we were smelling. Brian, it's delicious, isn't it?
Fantastic.
It's like I'd almost want to eat it, and it's very typical of the white flowers to have a lovely scent to them. I'm going to put this back down because I may want Louise and whoever else is out and about in final control to smell it. It's a very pretty flower, and it seems as though it's just popped up. It was growing on a little shrub underneath a bush willow. However, Louise, as sweet as what you may think that is, it is wilting with this rain, so I don't know how long it is going to last. It may just come back very sort of shriveled up, but at least it will smell nice. Now, like I said, you're going to see Brian, and I'm sure David's doing the same thing, wipe the lens. We need to just keep that squeaky clean, of course. Oh, but I have picked up on, looks like some elephants were around here at some point. There's a couple of footprints. Moving along the sand, let's see if we can maybe find them. Let's look very carefully around here. Seems as though we're having a dove morning. No, not staying. Now, Neutral, who's watching on Periscope, was wondering if malaria is a problem out here, and unfortunately it is, especially at this time of the year, just after we get the first rains. And the reason for that is because during the warmer weather, when the rains come, we get lots of puddles on the ground, and it forms perfect breeding environments for the mosquitoes. Now, the larval stage of the mosquitoes is an aquatic phase, and they are carnivorous as well. They eat all sorts of other little insects. And the Anopheles mosquito, which is the mosquito that carries the malaria, seems to like this area very, very much. And I've heard of a couple of people who have unfortunately picked it up. And it's quite, I don't know if any of you ever know too much about malaria, but it sort of feels as though like you're getting flu. Initially sore neck, sore throat, fever, really just feels like a common cold. But obviously it progresses, and we always say if you're out here and you're feeling a bit miserable, most of the time our first aid kits are stocked with malaria testing kits, which involves a prick of the finger. Well, and then it'll tell you almost automatically in a couple of seconds really if you've got it or not. And it's as simple as just going to the doctor and getting some medication and taking a course of this medication, and in a couple of days you're up and running again. But if you leave it for too long, if you leave it for more than 2 weeks, 3 weeks or so, and everybody's symptoms are slightly different. Some people feel the symptoms worse than others. And then, well, it can turn into cerebral malaria, and then that is what often kills you. So it's rather to be safe than sorry. Even if you come out on a safari holiday, I always used to tell my guests, maybe you often pick up colds in the aeroplanes with all the different people, but rather to be safe than sorry, just have a little prick of the finger, get it checked, and well, it's better than malaria. You wouldn't want to wish malaria upon your worst enemy. That is not a pleasant thing to have. So what they do often do is they come around to the camps. Like, we had the government actually come through, and they actually spray against the mosquitoes. And that sometimes helps a little bit as well. And we've seen an abundance of mosquitoes this year. Last year, I can't remember them being so bad. But this year, they're 100 times worse. But I also think we've had a little bit more rain than what we did last year, and it's got hotter earlier. But we'll just keep fighting them off. Oh, here, looks like we've got some miserable kudu trying to hide away from the rain. I mean, just try and find a spot, a little gap. It's obviously quite difficult. Oh, and an impala also lurking at the back. Now, ideally, it would be great if we could drive with the rain behind us so we didn't get any rain on the lens, but it's difficult. There's a young kudu bull trying to stay dry as well as eat breakfast. And it seems as though there's an entire family around here, but quite young. So you can just see his horns protruding out of his head, so probably coming on to about a year, maybe a year and a half old now. Here, a couple of impala are running past, and another kudu has just joined the party. I wonder why they're running back this way. Maybe they're just a bit nervous of us this morning. Here they are at the back. Looks like a bachelor herd. They're all looking straight towards us, so I presume it's us that they're looking at and a bit nervous of. There is another kudu. Slightly older bull, probably coming on to about 2 years old now. You can see the horns just starting to turn. And almost double the size of that young kudu that we saw earlier. But a little family living around here. And there's even a miserable vulture. And I think that the vulture sitting on the dead tree actually suits this weather perfectly today. I think we shall just look at this vulture for the rest of the morning. And you can see how unhappy it is with a grey sky. And well, that's not a very good spot to sit if you're trying to keep your feathers dry, vulture. I would go for a marula tree. But let's go back across to James and see if his waterproof jacket is working better than mine.
My waterproof jacket, everybody, cost me more than the feathers on that hardy-dar ibis. This is because in South Africa it is not possible to buy a jacket that is in fact waterproof. This jacket was purchased in England. It's supposed to be waterproof. We will tell shortly whether it is or not. It has always been a great mystery to me why it is that a plastic bag, for example, which costs less than 20 cents, is entirely waterproof completely, but it is almost impossible to buy a garment that is waterproof. I find it both distressing and deeply irritating, so hopefully this one will be a bit better. That hardy-dar would probably have flown off were it not for the fact that its feathers are filled with water. I do apologize, everybody. I've got pneumonia suddenly. Oh dear. Taylor and Brian, everybody, have given up. They're getting water into the camera lens. So the camera lens is about as waterproof as the proverbial teabag. I'm not sure why that hardy-dar ibis is now eating grass. It's a strange thing for a hardy-dar ibis to be doing. I suspect it's probably constructing itself some nest inner linings. And, while the other member of the family is perhaps sitting on the eggs, this one's been sent out to do some shopping. There's ominous thunder going in the background, everyone. The rain is starting to fall a little bit more heavily. If there is any danger, I'm afraid, if there's any danger of us damaging something, I'm afraid we are going to have to call this drive. Let's keep going up. We're sort of heading towards home anyway, so let's keep going up this way. We're going up the Marty drainage, where there are big trees. That's why I came here, to shelter from the storm. We have found nothing else since I last saw you, I'm afraid. Ah, James, thank you very much for a question that is in fact easy to answer. You say, which tree species produces the largest flowers out here? Jeffrey in Texas, if you're watching, you'll be able to answer this, as will Raisa in Finland. It is a sausage tree. Kigelia africana produces great big red flowers like that. I think that's probably by far the biggest flowers that are produced by a tree out here. And there's one example. What you got there? Really? Okay, everybody, David has said we're going to have to shut the lens. I'm afraid it's starting to get very wet. We will try and resurrect the tent, but we'll keep you posted on Twitter until then, and we will definitely go out again if it gets a little bit drier. And so we're going to have to, I'm afraid, say thank you for joining us and goodbye, I'm afraid. Okay, see you this afternoon.
Now, unfortunately, the rain is just getting too hard for us this morning. And luckily, though, we've come across this elephant who also seems to be trying to seek some shelter, as well as, like the kudu, trying to continue getting enough nutrients for the day. But I suspect that we're in for a big storm. Like I said, the thunder is brewing in the distance. There's a thick mist coming over the sky, and well, I'm looking very much like a drowned rat this morning. But it's been wonderful, of course, to spend the entire morning with you, but I think we're sadly going to have to say goodbye. So, well, these things happen when you're out here, but at least we had a good drive. We kept the cat streak up. Wasn't it fantastic? I'm not sure what day we're on. We must be on about day 65 now, somewhere around there. We're going to keep going, and hopefully we'll get to day 100. Now, we'll catch you a little bit later for the sunset safari, and hopefully hope that this rain clears up a little bit to give us some time. But for myself and Brian, have a lovely day, a lovely evening, good sleep, and we'll catch you a little bit later.